very, very honored to have Colorado State Representative Mike Foote. Representative Foote has served as a deputy district attorney in Boulder since 2004. In 2012, he was elected to the state legislature to represent the people of Eastern Boulder County. While in the legislature, he has passed dozens of bills into law, including increased penalties for oil and gas environmental violations. He has fought for working families and small businesses, all the while continuing his work as a deputy DA in Boulder. Mike completed his undergraduate degree at Indiana University, received a master's degree from Denver University in International Studies, and a law degree from the University of Colorado. He is an avid cyclist and outdoor enthusiast. He and his wife Heidi live in Lafayette and have two daughters. In February, Mike announced that he is running to serve as the district attorney of Boulder County, and his robust campaign is well underway. Representative Foote, thank you so much for joining us.
All right, well, good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for inviting me and for having me here. I'll tell you right off the bat, I don't have a PowerPoint. I mean, this picture is great, but I'm not gonna go through any slides. And what they told me is I can do PowerPoints. I'm happy to do them, but also as being an elected official for the last 6 years, I can guarantee you I could probably just stand here and talk for 20 minutes. But I hope that what I talk about is valuable, and as was said before, I'm happy to stick around at the end and take any individual Q&A after the program is done. I'll give you a little bit of background so that you know where I'm coming from, and then go into a little bit of the landscape of the state. I first ran for the state legislature, and I started in 2011. And one thing I heard when I got down to the legislature, which is actually very true, is that sometimes you pick the issues you deal with, and sometimes the issues pick you. And when it comes to the oil and gas issue, I would say the latter is very correct, at least for me. When I first started running in 2011, the city of Longmont, which is in my district, my house district, was adopting some new regulations. And during that time, they adopted some new regulations. They didn't go as far as some people wanted, but they went a lot farther than the industry wanted. So the industry sued. And in the midst of that lawsuit, a citizens group got together and decided that they were going to put on the ballot for the city a prohibition against fracking, period. And I think many of you know the rest of the story. That passed 60-40 in 2012. And you may or may not know, but Longmont is not nearly as blue of a city as the city of Boulder. Longmont is quite a purple city. And for something to pass 60-40 means that it had Democratic support, it had unaffiliated support, and it had Republican support. And so the city of Longmont passed that in 2012, litigation ensued. I think many of you know that since then, the Fort Collins case and the Longmont case was announced by the Supreme Court, which said that a 5-year moratorium and a outright fracking ban was found to be against state law. It was preempted by state law. It's not that it's unconstitutional necessarily. I think that's important. Maybe Dan will talk about that a little bit later. But it's against state law. It's preempted by state law. So anyway, that's been happening during the time that I've been a state representative down at the Capitol. And of course, the folks in Longmont, just like people here in Broomfield, and the folks in Lafayette have been very concerned about oil and gas development. So it's been a big issue of mine, and I've run a number of bills. I have to say, unfortunately, many of my bills have not passed, and I'll talk to a little bit about the dynamics of that. One that did pass in 2014 was a bill that increased penalties on oil and gas violations. That actually was the second year we ran that bill. I ran it first when it was one of my first bills introduced in 2013. To increase penalties. It didn't pass the first year, but it finally passed the second year. And I think part of the reason was that the governor and the Oil and Gas Conservation Commission and even the industry was so embarrassed at how low the penalties could be that they finally gave in and allowed us to pass this bill. Because the penalties had not been increased since the Eisenhower presidency, if you can believe that. So it was basically, the penalties were so low, it was pretty much the equivalent of a parking ticket for any kind of violation. So we did that, we got it passed, and that's great. But I'll tell you that for the 6 years I've been down there, really my experience down at the state level is that the oil and gas industry is in the driver's seat at the state. They are. The laws are very favorable to them, and it hasn't been an overnight phenomenon, but it's been the course of many years where this law has been tweaked a certain way, this law has been tweaked a certain way, the interpretation of the laws have been tweaked a certain way, and then also it really comes down to how they're administered as well. The governor and who the governor appoints to the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission and to a lesser extent the Department of Public Health and Environment really do matter in these cases. Right now in the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission, you may know that they don't deny permits. The oil and gas industry goes to the commission, they ask for a permit to drill, the commission doesn't deny it. Now, sometimes they go back and say, well, go back and try it again so we can approve it when it comes back the next time. This isn't right or that isn't right. So it's not entirely fair to say that they just always rubber stamp it, but they don't deny it. They come back, the industry will come back, and they'll resubmit a permit based on the feedback they get from the Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission. Then, after the state grants the permit, it goes to the city or the county to then decide what they're going to do with that particular permit. And there's probably not enough time to get into all the intricacies of preemption and the kinds of powers that the city councils or county commissions have or they don't have. And my theory on that is the city councils and county commissions actually have quite a bit of power. Some are afraid to use it. Some aren't. But this has been the real conflict between local governments and between the oil and gas industry is what kind of power can be used. When it turns out that city councils or county commissions go a little bit farther than what the industry wants, then we see a lot of lawsuits, and that's what we've seen over the last several years, unfortunately. But going back to the state system, we have a system that's set up that is quite favorable to the industry, and I don't think that many people really would deny that, even if you talk to industry representatives behind the scenes. Of course, there are regulations and that have been put into place to try to ensure that things don't go bad, and those have to be followed or penalties are assessed. But the bottom line, at least in my opinion, is that if you have a company that wants to come in and they want to drill, even if it's close to a school or even if it's in a residential neighborhood, it's an uphill battle with the state in order to keep that from happening. That doesn't have to be how it is, but right now, that's how it is. Now, it also doesn't mean that cities and counties can't push back. And people can't push back with initiatives, and I'll get into that in a couple of minutes. There have been some changes over the course of the last 6 years since I've been down there. There have been a lot of attempts, and I can go over some of my bills very briefly, but there have been a lot of attempts. There have been some changes. I mentioned that the fines bill ultimately passed. There was a bill that ultimately passed this year. Your state representative, Matt Gray, passed this bill based on, it deals with forced pooling, and it makes the system a little bit better. At least a little bit better for those that are being forced pooled. So those kinds of things happen. But anything that I've run over the last several years that has been designed to change the system to make it more fundamentally equal between cities and people and the industry has failed. For example, I ran a bill a couple of years ago that would, in my opinion, it basically reasserted the local government's ability to exercise local control over siting of oil and gas facilities. Now, local governments have the ability to site all kinds of things. That's one of their main basic functions, is to site what happens with land use in their communities. If you want to put a factory somewhere, if you want to put houses somewhere, other businesses somewhere, local governments, that's their bread and butter. They site these things based, of course, upon the opinions of their community. And so, what I wanted to do is put oil and gas on the same level as every other land use. And we called it local control for oil and gas, just like you can for hard rock mining, just like you can for aggregate mining, just like you can for everything else. Well, long story short, that bill failed, and there's been subsequent efforts to run that, and that has also failed. So that was an effort to try to change the system a little bit that the industry fought back against, and unfortunately, one. Now, like I said, it doesn't have to be this way. And one thing that I would encourage you to do over the course of not only this election, but going forward, is to make sure that this is an issue that you ask candidates about up and down the ballot, from your city council to your governor candidates and everywhere in between. ask them specifically about what they think about local control, what they think about the role of oil and gas, what they think about where oil and gas should be allowed to be, if at all. And what you may hear, and hopefully you can kind of work through and ask additional questions, is a lot of times people that are running for office talk about we need to find an appropriate balance. You'll hear that all the time, and I would encourage you to go beyond that, because what that means is, in my opinion, status quo. Balance, well, the way it works out, the way that people talk about it is, the industry is allowed to drill. And there may be a little pushback here and there, but the bottom line is, they get to put their facility 1,000 feet away from a school. But they get to put their facility in the middle of a neighborhood, even after some resistance. And so, if we get candidates that ultimately win office that don't believe in this so-called balance, then I think progress can be made. If we elect a governor that is more interested in really enforcing, not only enforcing the laws that we have, but also making sure that the industry is called to account if they mess up, and also just putting a little bit of common sense into what's going on in the state, I think that can matter tremendously. Have a Colorado Oil and Gas Conservation Commission that will actually say no sometimes. Have a Colorado Department of Health and Environment that will say no sometimes. I think that's important. And also have a state that, instead of suing local governments for asserting their local control, actually trying to work with local governments and putting a little more common sense in what we can do. So all of that is possible. It just hasn't happened over the last several years because of the folks that have been in power in the state. Not everybody. We have a House of Representatives that have passed many of these bills that I think can make a difference. But the state Senate has killed many of them. And so it matters who's in the legislature, it matters who's in the governor's seat, and it matters who's in your city council and county commissions and other areas. And it matters in many ways, but make sure to really kind of dig in and get their views on it, and make sure that they're willing to, at least from the city level, push back against the state, and make sure that at the state level, they're willing to listen and accede to more local control on this issue. And that's not the only kind of fronts that we can push back on. Of course, having the right people in office is important. There are ballot measures that are on the ballot pretty much every year from a local level. Obviously, you're all familiar with 301 last year. I'm very familiar with it. And there's local level ballot measures and there's state level ballot measures. One that may get on the ballot this year is a 2,500 foot setback rule, which is much higher than what we have now. Right now, we have a 500-foot setback from houses and 1,000 feet setback from things like hospitals and apartments and schools. So that's, if they get enough signatures this year, that will be on the ballot as well. There's a lot of things you as citizens can do, and I think it can help change the system, but it's going to take some time and perseverance. And to that end, I don't know how much more time I have, actually, but... Okay, very good. To that end, I want to just extend my thanks to some folks in this room that I recognize that have actually helped us try to bring about this change down in the Capitol, and also what you've done here in Broomfield as well. It does matter. I think that we get some feedback sometimes. People come down to the Capitol, and the bill that they're advocating for doesn't pass, and perhaps what they see is state senators fiddling on their phone the entire time while you're testifying. And, of course, I apologize for that. That's unfortunate. And sometimes it may seem like the panel's not listening. And sometimes, admittedly, there's folks that may not be listening. But it takes perseverance, it takes effort, and it takes a lot of work to change a system like we have in place. We didn't get here overnight. We've had many of the laws in place since the 1970s. And they've been continually updated and tweaked over the course of time to make it more favorable to the industry. So we're not going to get away from where we are overnight. But I can guarantee you one thing, if people don't come down to the Capitol, if bills aren't run, if people aren't pushing back at city councils, if city council members aren't pushing back against the state, none of that's going to change. Right now, status quo is the way that the industry likes it. And we have to push back on multiple fronts, including legal fronts, which you're going to hear about a little bit later on, in order to change. So I realize I'm a little bit almost out of time here. As I said, I'm happy to take questions. I'm happy to talk further offline about this issue. I just think it's very important for us to keep at it. And I know that your state representative is doing it. I know that folks up in Boulder County are doing it and other places. It has to be a concerted effort, an effort that takes some time, but I'm confident that we can turn it around given all the effort and people like yourselves. So thank you again for having me. I really appreciate it.